Hey folks,
Kilt-Man here, Kilt-Man, at your services. How are you all? I hope you're doing very, very well. Now, first of all, those of you that know me, and those of you that watch the channel regularly, know that I like to put content out there pretty much every single day. And there's usually a bloody good reason why I don't do it on a particular day. And yesterday, even though my heart was in the right place, my spirit was willing and able to do a video, my body certainly wasn't. Because, yes, yours truly had his first COVID jab, the day before. And I had it at 3 o'clock on the Saturday afternoon. All well and good, yes. It was done in a jiffy, no pain, didn't even feel it going in. They may have lied, because I certainly wasn't looking. And I returned home and everything was normal. And then I was watching films into the wee small hours. That was my plan. And then at the stroke of midnight, the ominous, fateful stroke of midnight, I went from feeling really great to feeling really shite. A fever descended upon me, and I had to crawl up the stairs to bed, whereupon I could not sleep and have not slept for now 28 hours, 30 hours, more. I can't do the maths, but for a long time I haven't slept. And I had fevers, shivers, shakes. Every single part of me was hurting, except for the bit where they stabbed me with the needle. So it's almost like all the side effects that you get were listed there, and I could tick them all off. Yep. I felt sick, headaches, teeth were aching, everything was aching. So I was horizontal for almost 30 hours. I just could not move. So couldn't do a video, obviously. But today, I feel okay, except for one thing. The bit that wasn't hurting, where they stabbed me, is now hurting like hell. What's going on? What's going on? People are saying to you, that's a good sign. If you're really ill afterwards, it shows it's really taking effect and your body's trying to fight it and it's being assimilated properly. This is for your own good, and yet you feel really shit for 30 hours at least. Great. Oh, don't forget to come back for your second installment. Fuck you. And the worst thing is, it put me off whiskey until today. Kind of feeling okay now. I've missed you. You watch as that now goes out the hole in my arm. Anyway, folks, little unboxing here. Something is here to do with, well, there's a few major giveaways, isn't there? An alien derelict, one of them pesky facehuggers, and a rather large and resplendent poster for the film Alien. Plus, its soundtrack from Jerry Goldsmith is playing to accompany us. Plus, another big giveaway, I'm wearing Nostromo's cap and the Nostromo vest. That, courtesy of Astrodyne, your friend and mine, Astrodyne. That, courtesy of Steve007. We all know and love these guys, regular channel contributors. And also, Amazon Prime is a major contributor to the channel as well. Although, I have to pay for their stuff. Still working on that one. And here it is. Yes. Is it a derelict box? Who knows? Who knows what could lurk within? Yes. In space, no one can hear you scream. But even in space, Amazon Prime can still get their deliveries to you the next day. Isn't that great? Actually, this arrived the day I got my jab, but I had to wait because I was just so damn ill. Anyway, ski and do. And we're now going to make a clinical incision. Let's just hope it doesn't spew acid. Just have the floors waxed. Right. You've got to be careful doing this because... because of that. When you're going along the little seal and it suddenly goes like that. And you've suddenly pierced what is a rare bit of merch. Yes, yes, it can happen. That wasn't too bad, actually. Hang on. Oh, God. what's in here? What's in the box? Well, to tell you the truth, in all this excitement, I've forgotten myself. But on one side, we have brown paper. And on the other side, we have sweet chili chicken. What have we got there? Yes, alien. What does it say there? Big chap. Ultimate edition. Big chap. What's that you say? What's big chap? Weyland-Yutani and Nostromo and Xenomorph fans know exactly who I'm referring to here. This is from Neca. Neca, the gods. The gods of action figures. And my God, this year, 2021, they are pulling out all the stops. Oh my God. Get set, fans and collectors, to remortgage your properties, because to fund your collecting obsessions, you're going to have to. The classic Universal monsters are coming out again in better versions. You're getting American Werewolf. American Werewolf! American Werewolf, as in the big hairy chap, is coming out. And you're also getting MacReady from The Thing. Finally, MacReady! Yes! With a variety of interchangeable heads and accessories and, oh God. Can't wait. I know, there's been a MacReady figure before. Official. There's a lot of customised ones. But the official one, which I've got, he's there in the kennels with the shotgun, shooting at the air. The mutating husky dogs. Still can't bear that sequence. But finally it's coming out. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff coming out from NECA. And I've shown you many of NECA's stuff in the past. This figure here, the big chap, is the big alien. This is part of their range that came out last year in 2020, which was actually a year after the 40th anniversary, but that's when they came out anyway. Celebrating the 40th anniversary of it. And they brought out pretty much all the characters and the alien itself. And these are lavish, fantastic figures. You can get them all. Well, I think you can get them all. To be honest with you, I haven't seen the figure of Ash, but there must be one. I mean, I just haven't seen it. I haven't looked for it. But there's a Ripley one, there's Parker, there's Brett, there's Captain Dallas. And Dallas and Lambert are both wearing the pressure suits, the space suits, the big sort of samurai-inspired armor suits. Fantastic, what a great idea. And obviously, this dude. And this dude isn't alone, because he comes with the 1979 film version of the Egg, with a little facehugger and a chest burster. So, let's have a little tour around the box first, because NECA really do know how to package these things. So if you want to just display them without taking them out the box, which many people do, but they've spent so long crafting and manufacturing, sculpting and producing and painting. I said that in the wrong order. Manufacturing would be the last thing, really. But creating these things with great sculptors and artists, painstakingly going over original concept designs and frame by frame images from the Blu-rays, then, you know, you owe it to them to take it out the goddamn box and have a good look at it, at least. But no, it's worth a fortune. I'm just going to keep it in the box and only see one side of it. Well, look, collectors are a law unto themselves. Me, I collect, but I also play with too. So, I'll tour around the back of the box. There he is, the big alien. There's the chest burster. There is the facehugger and the egg. And there's the alien again, because this alien does have the inner mouth, the tongue mouth as well. Ooh! Ooch! Lovely imagery of the eggs there. And of course, the alien greenery, which is the dominant colour aesthetic of the alien movies. Green. So, Big Chap. Why is he called Big Chap? I know, you're all saying, open the box, just show me the fucking figure. Well, I will. In depth and close up, so don't worry about that. But first of all, Big Chap, where's that name come from? H.R. Giger, who designed the creature, from concept to, you know, from the egg to the facehugger to the chest burster, or the bloody turkey, as he called it, and the big alien, as he called it. He never called it the big chap, he called it the big alien, or the alien dessert. Alien dessert because if you had the first course, which was the egg, then you had the second course, the chest hugger. Chest hugger? The face hugger? I'm a chest hugger. Aye. See, my version of Alien would be a lot different. and then, obviously, the chest burster and the big alien itself. And the big alien would be the final course, your dessert. So, although having said that, Ridley Scott, I can imagine Ridley Scott saying, big chap. I can imagine him saying it like, but anyway, it was known as the big alien, primarily. It's manufacturers of merchandise and fanboys on all the alien fan sites and the William Tarney fan group and all that. It's them who christened it the big chap. But it's stuck, so it's there, and I'll go along with that. We all know big chaps. Jason Momoa is a big chap. Arnie Schwarzenegger is a big chap. Brian Blessed may seem like a big chap, but he's actually quite small, you know. He's got a big beard, and a big pair of lungs on him, and a big voice. But really, he's only small, but he casts the commanding presence of a big chap. The alien's alive! So, anyway, without further preamble, the little Velcro window box. Sorry if you're getting reflections here, but don't worry, I'm going to take him out of the box. But there's a nice image of the figure itself. And don't forget, this is the original Xenomorph from the first movie. Stan Winston changed the design for Aliens, obviously. And then, of course, you'd have different versions of the Xenomorph. A dog one, a cow one. The dragon one that all got all sorts of bloody aliens. But this is the first guy. Look at him there. And as you can see, there's the egg. There's the face hugger. Little chest burster. Ooh, hello. It's like he's been spat out. You've actually got the cycle there. Egg, face hugger, chest burster. But there's the big alien. That's wonderfully housed in there. Looks great. Yes, it does. I did hear some people saying that the dorsal spines, those little sort of reptilian, almost prehistoric spines on his back, were actually not attached. I'd seen this in a few reviews. I don't know if some of these earlier versions, and do correct me if I'm wrong, but I'd seen reviews saying that they were unattached and you had to put them in. I don't know how true that is, but clearly they are attached there. Thank the Lord. But anyway, to get into this now, we'll take some messing around with this and scissors and untying little bits of plastic twine. And that won't be very interesting for you guys. So, let's reconvene in exactly a flash. One big push and heave! And there he is, folks. Hello, hello everybody, hello. Yes, I'm the star of the show. Oh yes. Look at this guy. Neca's 1979 anniversary alien Xenomorph big chap figure in all his resplendent biomechanical, weirdly alien, well, very alien design. Look at that, look at that. We'll come on to him in a bit. First of all, let's look at the egg. It's the egg. What came first, the Xeno or the egg? Well, in the whole convoluted canon of the alien sort of life cycle, in the first movie, what is it? Well, you get the egg. The face hugger impregnates, lays the embryo in a living host. It is given birth, it grows. According to Ridley Scott, Dan O'Bannon, Ronald Shuster and all that, who did the original screenplay, and Walter Hill as well was involved in all of this. The life cycle of the alien itself was only a few days, so it had to like do its thing and then settle down and cocoon itself and die, basically. But what it would also do, because there was no concept of the queen in the first movie, a queen laying the eggs. So what's laying all these eggs? I don't know. Must be something we haven't seen yet. Well, in the original idea, there was never going to be a queen. The idea was, well, these things just, they give birth, and the alien then with certain victims will egg morph. So it'll cocoon victims and it will somehow impregnate those cocoons so that another egg will be produced with a facehugger inside it, and that's what's going to happen. So it would lie in wait for some unsuspecting space traveller to inadvertently stick his face right in the bit, that big opening. Oh, hello. Duh. That was the idea. And of course, with aliens for James Cameron, Stan Winston designing them, and that concept gave birth, literally, to the Alien Queen. Now, in a lot of fan supposition, the Alien Queen can also only be caused, created by egg morphing. So in other words, like the first alien with in the uncut scene, well, if you watch the director's cut, it's there. Brett's body's been cocooned, Dallas's cocoon. Ripley, kill me. What can I do? Yeah. All that sequence, which is spellbinding and haunting and brilliant, I love it. And I can understand why it was jettisoned from the original theatrical cut, but for me, that should always be there. That I can't watch the film without that sequence. I genuinely can't. I think it's just awesome. But I get why. So it will take victims and it will cocoon them and then create. But the idea is, in the fan sort of mythos, is that only via that way can you create a queen in the first place. Hey, it's all fiction. Or is it? Who knows? But I've just had that COVID Weyland Yutani jive in my arm. So who knows what's going to come bursting out of me. A big bottle of whiskey, hopefully. But anyway, folks, here you go. This is the 1979 Alien Egg. Now, this is in two parts, right? So that tentacled base, which is wonderful, isn't it? Look at that. Look at that. Very Lovecraftian, the way you look at that. Sort of Little Shop of Horrors as well. So you've got innards there, and you've got the tendrils, the membrane of these sort of petals that unfurl back. Brilliant. What you're seeing down there, that pink base there, is the base of this. This egg just slots on and you click it in. So, but the paintwork on the outside is magnificent, and the detail, the sculpting is wonderful. Isn't that wonderful? It's great. And as I say, the veins and all the little tendrily bits are icky and you're not going to stick your face in that, are you? Unless the script tells you to. But that is wonderful. Wonderful. I will say that, I don't know if you can pick that up there, but when you click it in, I don't know if it's a discrepancy in the paintwork or what, but one of the bits where it clicks in, you probably can't see that. You can actually see the pink there of the base. So it's almost like, well, you should have really covered that with the paintwork. But then again, if you're slotting it in and out, you're probably going to wear it off anyway. And let's be honest, once it's on, you can't see it unless you scrutinise. And why would you take the egg off the base? You're not going to, are you? So, there's the base. What's in the base? The face hugger. There's one there. Wonderful. Wonderful. Yes. It's also, like much of the design work of the alien and this creature, it's very feminine and vaginal. The openings on the derelict are big vaginal openings. They are the organic passageways. The underside of the facehugger. Is the unfailing of petals there, and if we look on the big guy himself, which we're going to come on to, if we look just down here, it ain't got a willy. It might have a big tail, but it ain't got a willy. It's got a little orifice. Look at that. Vagina. Yeah, The thing about Alien is it is partly invested in the fear of male rape and male impregnation. That's always been part of that. And you can go, oh, no, it's just a monster. No, there's underlying concepts which make this film so indelible within the genre and why it's been so long-lasting and why even learned critics will always write theses and essays on this movie, because there's a lot more going on beneath the scenes. In a way, it's kind of clever that Ridley Scott messed around with Jerry Goldsmith's score for the movie and used some of Goldsmith's score for the earlier film, Freud. Freud, about the psychoanalyst. A lot of sexual angst, sexual stuff lurking beneath the surface. The most exciting tracks in the score for Alien, in the soundtrack, I mean, not the score. Jerry Goldsmith wrote a much different score, but what they used in the film, and you'll probably hear because I'm playing the full, complete listing, is the best bits from Freud, which are really exciting. And Ridley Scott chose those. Ordinarily, and I've discussed it before, I've done videos on this, that I don't like directors screwing about with composers' work. But they have the reasons. And in this particular case, I will say that what Ridley Scott came up with for Dallas in the Air Shaft, which you're hearing now actually, is fabulous and better than what Jerry Goldsmith himself came up for the actual sequence in the movie. Anyway, the facehugger. There it is. Now, there's some manipulability, is that a word, for the fingers? Some, not much. There's no wires in those fingers, but they can be kind of bent around a little bit to do certain positions. The tail has a wire running down it to about there, so it can be moved about, but you'd have to, if you're going to wrap it around another character's face, because hey, if you've got the full set, you're going to want to do it anyway, aren't you? You could probably do it. I mean, of course you could do it. You can wrap it around and you just a bit of blue tack. I always say blue tack, never goes amiss. A bit of blue tack there and you'd be all right. Douche, it's going to stick round. But that is a wonderful, wonderful recreation of the facehugger. So you've got all the, it's horrible, nasty doobries. I mean, there's me going about vaginas and that, like, but if you did encounter the vagina that looked like that, don't stick your face in it. Or anything else, for that matter. So, the egg. The facehugger. Where the hell did I put the chest burster? Oh yes, he's here. He's here. Isn't that awesome? I know, I can't get the complete detail in on this lousy camera, but you know, you're getting the point. The closer I move it, the less you can see, you know. But that is a great little piece, that. The arm, the little tucked in arms. Obviously in Aliens, Stan Winston gave, when he saw the chest burst, he gave it arms that moved around, little T-Rex style. But they're there, you can see them. You can see its little face, it's like, arr! By the way, you know who made the noises for the chest burster? Percy Edwards. Percy Edwards, folks, was a guy that in the UK on TV in the 70s, he had a program where he could do animal impersonations, usually parrots, a lot of it was birds and stuff like that. But he was really good at vocalizing animal sounds. He was recruited to do the sounds of this guy and the big alien as well, which does make some noises throughout the movie. Percy Edwards, that's him there. Now this, we have a little bit of blood and smearage on it. Not too much. We know that in the finished version of the movie, the blood was cut down a hell of a lot. Initially, the blood was way, way in excess. And poor old Veronica Cartwright playing Lambert did a backflip with 2 pints of fake blood in her face. It destroyed the effect. There was just too much gore in the effect. So In the finished film, the version that we've all seen, whichever version you watch, there's a lot less blood and guts in it. But there's enough. And, you know, shit, what's that like? Oh, God! It's brilliant, isn't it? It's just sheer brilliance. Now, as I say, there's a little wire. Like the facehugger, there's a little wire in this tail as well. But it doesn't go all the way down. It kind of, I don't know, is that a mistake? Should it go all the way down so you can do more manipulation? I mean, I'm not going to second guess anyone who creates and sculpts these things and manufactures them, but I don't know. But you can obviously make little, you can turn corners. But it is. And there's me going about like vaginas and all that, like. And those that know me know I go on all about them a lot. I couldn't even say it then. My tongue was getting too excited. But that is very phallic. That's very phallic. The chest burster itself is, if the alien and most of the alien imagery is vaginal, that is phallic. The whole thing is bloody sexual. It is. Does all this obsession say more about me than it does about the film itself? I don't know. Anyway, folks, I'm not wrong. These are all known elements. But here we go with the big guy. The big guy. Ridley Scott always said he didn't want... He hated horror movies because it was always a guy in a rubber suit. So that's what he didn't want. So what did he do? Got a big guy in a rubber suit. But wisely, he recruits H.R. Giger, Swiss surrealist, working with bones and machinery and tubes and prophylactics and all that kind of stuff to come up with design work for it. To make it biomechanical. And he gets the biggest guy he can find. And of course, Bolajai Badajo, who was from the Maasai tribe in Africa, who was a student in London at the time, was recruited to play the alien. And, you know, as lore has it, that Ridley Scott was with the agent in a pub in London, and he came in, you know, going to meet this guy, and the guy came in basically on his hands and knees, and then stood up to his 6'10". Although, having said that, I've seen him cited as being a 6'10", but also 7'2". So, hey, make of that what you will. Either way, bloody tall. Sadly, he's now deceased. Something like that anyway, which is a sad loss. I think he only ever did this alien, but he was a student and he didn't mind posing nude to be cast and molded in the suit, which H.R. Giger eventually came up with. With all of these dorsal, I don't know, bones, the long tensile tail, with the pincer hook. The pincer on the end would change throughout the movies. That would become something different. There is a wire in this tail as well. I know you're going to ask. But it only goes to so far. You could have guessed that, couldn't you? It only goes to like there. So that bit's kind of like, ooh, a bit loose. Now, we have the ankle jabbers there. We have all of the mechanical, sort of almost machine-like veins and tendrils and what have you, the makeup, the elbow spikes, the hands, the long hands with the claws. Now, H.R. Giger designed this. This is the look that he gave it. After many other designs, and Ron Cobb and who else? Roger Christian, I think it was. I don't know. John Mollo, maybe. Gave different designs for the alien. And they some kind of weird octopoid creatures and just more standardized man in a rubber suit style things. Ridley Scott went, no. I want something that looks utterly bizarre, which doesn't look like it should be able to work. It's part organic, it's part machine. What the hell is it? So the initial idea was going to be translucent as well, a sort of yellow, orangey, translucent colour, so you'd see all the workings inside. initially inside the translucent skull cap, which you have here. There was going to be maggots. They wanted live maggots in there to be seen moving around in there, which is a great idea. So that in close-ups you'd see, well, you wouldn't think they were maggots. You'd just think that it's bits, it's brain working. But the maggots under the studio lights went to sleep, so kind of ruined that one. So they ended up in I'm a Celebrity, Get Me Out of Here, and got eaten by, you know, fake celebrities to try and remake their name and reclaim some glory. But the skull is meant to be seen, and part of it, I don't know, you probably won't pick that up on this, but on Neca's model here, you can see part of the skull with the eye sockets, because even though in the film the alien appears to have no eyes, it does have the eye sockets from a human skull, because Geiger used the top half and front half of the human skull and put that in there with this translucent cover plate to show all the inner workings. So in close-ups you can see it, but you've got to look for it though. You've got to look for it. Now, and of course, the infamous mouth within a mouth, and Neca have got that, they've got it covered. This lower jaw does move down, and you can, there he goes. Oops, let's get out of the way there. In fact, that's a sequence there. This is where he's taking Parker out. And then he goes for Lambert. And of course, his tail goes between Lambert's feet and rises upwards. And the idea is that he has raped, mutilated her, and hung her from the ceiling. You don't see that. I know you don't, but enough is implied. And it is in the lore that he does do things with hair. He's only got a short time, a short lifespan. He may as well have some fun. But there he is, there he is. Articulation, fabulous, fabulous. Arms move all, every which bloody way. Hands move around, elbow, ball jointed, knees at ball jointed. You've got lots of hinge on the hips. You've got the wire in the tail, the feet, the toes turn up. There you go. And the feet do swivel on the ankle. The head, plenty of movements on the head. The head's nice and, there's a lot of movement on the head. It's not too loose either, which is kind of nice. You've got these weird, which I've never noticed before. These, you probably can't catch that. Maybe there, you can see just in there a little wire going across. But it kind of, these are, well, I don't know what they are. And are they on the alien? Well, they clearly must be, but I've never noticed them before. These sort of like cords that run around the neck and go down to the top of its back, basically. So I don't know. But they must be there, clearly. Geiger used condoms in some of the mechanisms, because condoms are translucent and they stretch, so that when the body would move, it would look as though they were sinews moving and sort of a membrane in motion, which works perfectly well in the movie. Carlo Rambaldi, as I said earlier, Geiger designed the entire creature, and he designed the suit for Bolajai Bejo to wear, but he did not do the head. He designed it, but it was manufactured by Carlo Rambaldi. Carlo Rambaldi, who would go on to do E.T., the friendlier face of outer space. And King Kong in 1976, the remake, he would do some of the hydraulics for that. And a lot of great effects, but also a lot of really shit ones as well. Conan the Destroyer, the Dagoth, which is one of the worst prosthetic animatronic things. It's ghastly. But his work on this is extraordinarily good. I think, given his talents, his bad effects would only be down to a lack of time and budget, just restrictions like that. Otherwise, his stuff would all be exemplary, because that is extraordinary. The head in the movie is extraordinary. We barely see the alien, and that was Ridley Scott's idea, of course, all the way through. Don't show it. It's a man in a suit. And yet one of the great deleted scenes is where it stands up in front of Lambert in the crucial sequence where it does kill Parker and Lambert. And Lambert sees it first. I love the film as it's finished now, in both theatrical and director's cut, where she just sees and the shadow raises up in front of it, and Parker's still shifting stuff, like, and he goes like, and then he sees what she's looking at. I do love that, but in the full version where she's on one end of the frame and the alien just slowly, out of a little crouch, gets up and stands up to its full height, I love that. But it's so clearly a man in a suit at the same time. So I really do get why Ridley Scott went, can't use it. Atmospheric and full of suspense and tension, but it's still just giving away what's going on. So every time you see this guy, up until the final scenes where he gets blown out of the airlock of the Narcissus shuttlecraft in Ripley's Last Stand, and even then he looks fantastic, but you barely ever see anything of him. It's just in certain positions, certain moves. And it's worth noting that Bolaji Bajo, or Badajo, who played him most of the time in that suit, he did all the sort of the pirouettes and the sort of the arty shots, the weird sort of positions, the athletic, the balletic design work. Whereas it was actually a stuntman who did the action work, which was Eddie Powell. Great stunt, Eddie Powell, awesomeness. For Hammer, went for Hammer and many other movies and studios. But he played the alien in many of the action sequences. So, you know. But Neca have knocked it out the park again, as usual. The package of this, to have the egg, which looks so, so good. So horribly creepy, and yet so horribly sexual. Is it just me? The facehugger, which looks so horribly scary and so sexual. Is it just me? The chestburster, which looks so horrible and scary and so sexual. Is it just me? And the big chap. And what's more sexual than having a big chap? Yeah, it's all built around sex. I will say that is a little bit loose. So, no, all you gotta do is go and he's out. I think I prefer that, so you have to pull it out. But either way, that mouth does move, the jaw does close, so you can seal it in there. I don't know if you can see that sort of smoked glass effect on that carapace, that dome. But all the machinery coils, there's bits of Rolls Royce were incorporated into it, coils and tubes. There's all sorts of things went into it. I mean, look at it. It is biomechanical, which is why they approached H.R. Giger. He worked with bones and wires and tubes and steel and all sorts and combined it all into the most bizarre, crazy sculptures. So he was the guy to design this, the ultimate xenomorph, the ultimate man in a suit. Articulation, as I say, is brilliant. There's lots you can do with it. Well, hey, you know, you can do some taekwondo kicks. Yeah. And he can reach for Tom Skerritt as Dallas. Yeah. And obviously he can hold Brett, Harry Dean Stanton, and then whoosh, whoa. Hey, he's a jaunty kind of guy, really. Yeah. It ain't all bad. So yeah, folks, there you go. That's Neca's 1979 anniversary edition of the Alien Big Chap. And it's wonderful. The paintwork is extraordinarily detailed and good. The detail is just to die for. And everything is there. Everything is there. And yeah, the Vulcan thing, you know, you've got all, oh God, live long and egg morph. But at Christmas, live long and eggnog. But there he is. And he's 9 inches tall, by the way, 9 inches. So if you get the other figures in this range, he will tower above those because they're all to scale. So yeah, I should have said that at the start. He's 9 inches tall. So that's quite a chunky, large figure to have on your shelf, you know, and do your stuff with. And you can, I say, you can do a lot with him. Lots of poses you can get him into. You know, he could be running for gold. You know? Wait! Let me on that shuttle! Actually, looks quite good like that. He does look athletic. Even with that big silly head, big banana head, but he couldn't half shift himself, couldn't he? Whoa! So, folks, there you go. That is the Alien 1979 Neca. A Neca, you can expect a lot more Neca reviews coming. Let's just show you again. The egg. Marvellous. That's not so marvellous, but you're not going to see it from that way, are you? But that is outstanding. It looks icky, it looks real. There's a glistening effect on it. One of these guys. And one of these bestie babies. You can set this up in a great sort of life cycle. You could do that with this. Have it on your shelf with him bursting out somehow or other, then going on to that and him stuck beside. Or you can have him just, you can have the face hugger draped over the side. That. You know? I don't know. It's up to you. God damn it. Yeah, he just slots back on. So, anyway, folks, there you go. Hope you enjoyed that. Please take it easy, keep cool, carry on, and just have fun, y'all, because we're only here for one thing, as far as I'm concerned, and that's to have fun. Otherwise, what is the goddamn point? Hey, think about it. We're here to enjoy ourselves. So please, in the meantime, and this hugely vaginal xenomorphic in between time, please do take it easy, keep it kilted, keep it Celtic, and I will see you all later in space. No one can hear you scream.